When I was about, I'd say about 11 years old, me and my younger brothers and cousins and friends, we were out in our chicken coop that wasn't quite finished, so the windows were open. And we were playing in there. It was kind of cold. It was in March. And we were flying a kite, and we only had one kite, so we were all huddled around this one kite. And we let it out as far as it could go, and then as we were reeling it back in because we started to get cold, one of the kids, he looked this way. He looked down the road, and he said, Who's that guy watching us over there?" And we all looked, and we're like, we didn't know who it was. But whoever it was, he was really big. He was tall, taller than our little fence pole, came up to him about to here. And the fence pole, we later found out, was about 5 foot something, maybe 8. He looked kind of hairy. He had no neck. His neck was really short like that. And he seemed like he had really long arms. Because he would stand there and watch us, and every now and then he'd lean over like this. And then he'd stand back up and watch us some more. And we were frantically winding in our kite, and we wouldn't let it go. And then it started to snow a little bit. And as it got more and more snow, his coloring, it became gray from the snow. But he stood there, and then finally one of my little brothers, he said, "I'm going to go tell Dad." So he ran out of the door and was heading around the corner, and within that split second, it was gone. It ran into the trees. So it disappeared, like, just in a blink of an eye.
Did you think it was a Sasquatch or
we've never heard of Bigfoot or Sasquatch. We've heard of the boogeyman and the Urtzi, the monster. And, you know, our parents scared us with those mythical creatures. But we never heard of Bigfoot or Sasquatch, and we called it the big black figure.
Could you recall what year that would have been?
I would say that was 1960. I was born in 55, so I was about 11 or 12, so about 67 maybe.
Okay.
And there was about 8 of us, 8 kids, that we all seen it. And it never really came around again after that time, till later in the 70s. That's when there were more sightings. And in the sighting that I'm going to tell you about now was my brother Ed. He was up in an area we call Coyote Basin, and he was hunting on his horse. He had a rifle on his back, and he was hunting. And it was getting dusk, and he was going to head home. Then he decided, "Well, I'm going to try one more place to see if I can find some." And so he goes over this ridge. And he said everything happened like in a split second. It was like slow motion, he said. And what happened was him and his horse came over the ridge. And he said he saw the horse's ears go like that, like, and it just stopped. And then they all looked at each other. And at the very bottom, way down there, there was this Bigfoot sitting down there. And he was eating something like that. And he was eating some off the ground, and then he looked up at him like that. And he said the look that he gave, that Bigfoot gave them, was the look of murder. That's how he described it to me. And he said that thing just came up on all fours, like just leaped. He said like within four leaps, he was already halfway up, just boom, boom, boom. And he said he could actually see the muscles rippling and the hair, and that look in its eyes. And he said it was fast. He said it just bound up at him. And in that instant, that horse did that with his ears. He just turned like that. And my brother almost fell off, and he grabbed that horse's neck. And they took off down to the foothills. And he said he couldn't stop his horse for nothing.
Do you remember hearing other stories from people in that area?
Yeah, there was one where this old rancher guy lived out in the Red Canyon area by Trout Creek. And he said he came home to his trailer one night, came home late from somewhere. and he said he seen it as he pulled in. He seen it. It was by in the field, and he had an old car, and he saw it, and it ducked, and it was trying to hide behind this big sagebrush, but the sagebrush couldn't hide it. And so he put his headlights are on it, and he starts panicking. He got scared of it, and he's trying to back out. And he backed out, and he is trying to go, and he got stuck. And so he's stuck, and his headlights are still aimed at that thing that he sees. And so he's finally gets it in gear, and he takes off. But he said it was really big, and it was really fast. And he did notice it jumping on the sagebrush as it ran off. And then the next day, or a few days later, he found his horses. They were laying in a gully, and I actually saw the horses. And they were, I would say it was a massacre. It was a little ravine, a little gully, and there was four dead horses in there. And what had happened was their necks were all ripped out, just about, you know, a horse neck. Yeah. That big was a big, just a rip on all of them. And also their butt, their tail end area, they were all ripped. They were just laid out and dead. And whatever killed them had to have been fast, because if you imagine horses, you know, they're pretty fast. And if something's being attacked, the other ones are going to go. But it got all of them.
Where you grew up, there were a lot of horses. Did you hear other stories of horses being spooked by this?
My sister, they live by the river. And a lot of times they're... horses were being bothered by something outside, and they would, you know, have that. They'd go out and try to scare it off, and sometimes there'd be a bad odor outside. But I remember one time they lived in this little old house, and they had left. And the kids were home with their uncle who was in college, and they were in the house, and they said something climbed on the top of the house, and it was big, whatever it was, really big, and it was walking around and jumping around. And they got really scared of it, and so the college student, he got them all together, and they were crying, and he put them in the middle of the room, and they had their gun. He got a gun, a rifle, and he was aiming at the door and looking for whatever was up, bouncing around and stomping. And he said it was doing that for a while, and the kids were just crying. And then it went to this kitchen area, which is kind of low. It was about 8 feet. And it really, they said it was really jumping hard over there. Then it went back, and just then Beatrice came home, and that thing took off, jumped off the house and took off. And the CISO, he didn't realize that it was, that they had come home. And when she opens the door, there they are, facing a rifle aimed at them, because, you know, they were scared.
And who's Beatrice?
My sister. And she was like, what's going on? And the kids were hysterical. But another one, I actually remember this one, was my niece, George. She was, we were washing dishes. And at that time, we had to heat water, then dump the basin water out onto the porch. And so she went outside to dump her dishwater, and we had this old black truck parked, and we had trash in it, you know, just so we can take it to the dump. And she said when she walked out, there was something big leaning into it, and it was eating, and she said it was making like an ugly slurping noise. And then it looked up at her, and she just screamed and threw her little basin of water and just ran back in. And she said it really smelled bad outside, too, when she opened the door and they kind of seen each other. But she wouldn't empty water for a long time in the dark.
Wow. And that's in the early 70s.
Yeah, same time. It all happened within, I'd say, 2 or 3 years.
I remember it being in the newspapers in the early 70s.
Yeah.
There were several others I'd heard about in North Fork.
Yeah.
Remember hearing about those?
No, I just remember about the one at Ray Lake where the kids seen it. And that's the one that made it into the papers. And I think they took a cast of the film.